A while back, you may remember that I did a video on the worst car in the world. And I deemed this the Pegassi Tesseract the worst vehicle ever made, all things considered. However, that got me thinking. You see, while this may be the worst car in the world, what is the best car in the world? Well, to find out, we have to start all the way back when the car really took off, in the 1930s. Yes, the recession had just begun, World War II was on the horizon, and Albany debuted the Roosevelt, which is, make no mistake, a fantastic car. Especially for American gangsters. However, it's not the best 1930s car, because as great and as historically significant as this car is, you can't beat the French in this case. You see, this is one of the most expensive cars in the world, actually. They made 10 of them. And it's made by Truffade. It's called the Z-Type. Yes, I am driving a $10 million, I think it's sold auction for $15 million, luxury sports car V12 in it, making over 200 horsepower in 1930, and I am cocooned in the finest hand craftsman work. It's ridiculous how expensive and rare this car is, and I'm driving on the motorway and I feel very scared. I don't want to breathe on this car the wrong way, but it's a damn nice car. It's nice, it's very comfy, it's got the luxury factor, it's got the handmade, it's got the rarity. It really is the perfect car of the 1930s. Now I just need to drive it home without having a heart attack at the nearest speed bump. Because this is all very expensive and exquisite. I'm going to bring back to the World Wars because, they kind of hindered automotive production, really. Except for this, made by Albany. It's called the Hermes. And it was, make no mistake, a very, very good coupe. It looked very nice. However, it really came into its own when it helped launch the lowrider craze. That would be very prevalent in the 50s and 60s. It is damn good looking. It's got air suspension. This is actually my personal car. I own it. That's how much I love this vehicle. And it's by far and away the best 40s vehicle in terms of looks, comfort, styling, and historical significance for the automotive world, really. There's no alternative for the 40s. The Albany Hermes is the best. However, as we move into the 1950s, this is when things started to go a bit mad. This is the transition period. Because we had Volkar making the Swedish automotive presence known with the Fagaloa, their first successful vehicle. We had the definition of luxury with the Enis Stafford breaking into the market. And sports cars, oh, we had plenty of those. Most notably the Lampadati Casco, combining Italian looks with incredible performance. It was a masterpiece. However, we do have to go to another Lampadati for the best car in the 50s. This is the Pigtail. That's what I call it. It's like the Pigali, whatever. I call it the Pigtail. And, there's nothing ugly about this, is there? It's one of the most revolutionary cars ever made, really, certainly in the 50s. It had hydro-pneumatic suspension, which meant it was sporty and yet incredibly comfortable. I'm sitting in here and I feel like I'm in that Stafford earlier, only I'm in a Lampadati, which is better. Because Lampadati is, of course, one of the best manufacturers ever made, by far. And this is one of their really big hits. One of their first big hits to enter them into the mainstream. No small feat, that. But the 60s. is when the car culture reached its peak, some would say. And there were so many beautiful, exquisite cars coming out left, right, and center. We had every manufacturer you can think of. We had Volcar, we had Pegassi, we had Grotti, we had everyone making exquisitely gorgeous cars. We had one of the most famous movie cars of all time, the JV700. In one decade, that is an incredible roster of vehicles. And they're all very fast, they're all very sporty. And some of them do look a bit better than others, with the Gullwing here being one of those prime examples. However, we do have to go to America to find the best one. This is the Class A Mamba, and it's a British sports car with a massive American V8 shoved in it, and that means this is seriously fast. Whoa, and seriously oversteer. This thing can do 0 to 60 in less than 4 seconds in 1965. Whoa! It is an absolute joy to drive. There is so much power going to the rear wheels, and it's so light, you can just absolutely chuck it about. However, you don't even need to do that, because it's controllable enough, thanks to its better suspension, that you could take this 500 horsepower lightweight monster around an autocross stage. Here we go. Airtime, yes. Use that power to get around the hairpins nicely, kick the back end out, get some wheel spin. That's just half the fun. It's a real driver's car. You gotta get this thing to work for you. But once it does get to work, it is a fun thing to drive. Just chuck it about, weaving it back and forth, and there we go. Across the line. Unfortunately, by the 1970s, the legendary muscle cars and sports cars of the 60s had gone by the wayside because of the gas crisis, spiking prices up dramatically. And fuel efficiency reigned supreme, but that doesn't mean there weren't a few exceptions. It led Japan to make its rise and shine with the Karen 190Z here, looking darn nice while doing it. And Lampadati, of course, bringing the swing back with this. This is the Trofeos Rally, and it's the most successful rally car in the world. Why is it one of the most successful rally cars ever made? Simple. Because it was purpose-built for rallying. No other vehicle had ever been designed just to go rallying, and it may not look it with its mid-engine Grotti V6 and its incredible styling. However, this thing, whoa, was designed for the rally's tracks, and it did good. Now, the winner would be Italian, but not Grotti. Now, yes, all you fans are out there going, well, hang on, that car's from the 60s, and yes, the Monroe is from the 60s, but it wasn't until 1971 they really nailed the point home, because the 60s cars kind of caught on fire, but with this new 1971 version that actually worked properly and didn't catch on fire, which means you could enjoy the speed without having to worry about exploding. And that's nice. That's why I'm saying the Pegassi Monroe from 1971 is the best car of the 70s. Because it enjoyed the driving experience already perfected by the 1960s Monroe. The 1980s just like the people went a bit mad. And we had all sorts of crazy stuff going on. Pegasi again swiping back with a bright purple wedge of legendary V12 goodness that also doubled as a flamethrower once in a while. We had Willard of all manufacturers making the fastest car in the quarter mile with the Faction Turbo, able to do a sub 13 second quarter mile with a V6. And this. This is the 1982 Übermach Zion. And you see that car over there, that Super Saloon? Yeah, this pretty much set the base mark for all of this. This is the origin point because straight six, 250 horsepower. It was later converted into a four-seater, but this is a 2+2 right now, and it still shifts! God, that's good pickup for a 2+2. And that noise is refreshing. The straight six, that's 120 miles an hour, 125. Holy crap. Oh, that is intoxicating. And of course, the history of having the first sports sedan ain't bad. The 90s were next, and consider this the era of touring cars. Annis entered the Elegy here in Australia, as did these fellas with the STD tuned car here being the Sentinel. And they were all well and good. I mean, hell, we had Nebula here, the Nebula Turbo, being a fantastic, reliable little safe car for the money, best for the value for sure. But you also had the opposite end of the spectrum. The supercars were rising into precedence. And as great as this Ocelot was for the world record for fast production car, this does take the cake. Behold the GP1. It was Progen's first production car, and I gotta say, as a first production car, this is pretty damn good. Okay? Mid-engine V12, you know, 620 horsepower, carbon fiber chassis. Whoa! Top speed of 240 miles an hour without a turbocharger in sight. It's one of the most legendary cars ever made. And it had good handling. And it won Le Mans first try. That is quite a resume. I mean, there's nothing more you need to say about it. It's a GP1. Everyone knows the GP1 is one of the greatest sports cars of all time. I'm pretty sure it's written in the Bible somewhere. Whoa! If I did that in any other mid-engine car, I would be spinning into the wall. But not this one. You can just chuck it about. There's just so much control with this car. It's so easy to drive. It's just so easy and so fast and so important to the automotive lexicon. It's pretty obvious why this is the best car of the 1990s. The new millennia led to a rise in technology, innovation, more so than the GP1 did. none speaking truer to this than the Swedish company Overflod, making the fastest production car in the world, hitting 250 miles an hour. But if you want to talk about technological revolution, there's no other option than this. This is a coil, Voltic, first production car again, and not quite as great as the GP1 in terms of speed, but in terms of acceleration, it's on another level because it's electric. If you couldn't tell already. And it's the only electric car in the world I actually like. You see, most electric cars are garbage. Because they can't stop, they can't turn, they can't do anything but go very fast in a straight line and accelerate. This, though, is the opposite. It's not very fast in a straight line, but it can handle unlike anything else. The grip is simply astonishing. And sure, the range is terrible, but in terms of a trendsetter with the future of electric cars, this really was a pioneer. And you gotta love pioneers with their mad, crazy ideas, and this one just about paid off. And the 2010s continued that technological evolution with Wagner right here from Dubachi absolutely blitzing the ring record. Even Ocelot was making supercars again, bringing this CX-75 thingy, forget the name of it. They're absolutely mental machines, all-wheel drive, V12s, V8s, turbochargers, even four-door sedans were getting 600 horsepower. Hybrids were becoming a mainstream thing with the 811. Everything was going nuts. And you gotta go back retro because nostalgia started really seeping in the 2010s. And this Dominator really shows that to the nth degree, despite how great it was. Which is why you're probably confused as to why you're currently looking at a Blista. Now, the Blista is my favorite car I've ever driven, more than any supercar, any sports car, any muscle car, anything, because it perfectly embodies what a car should drive like. It is fun handling, it's practical, it's cheap, and it's just a riot. It's not going to blitz any records of any kind in any way, shape, or form, but it doesn't need to. It's all about driving pleasure in an era of raw speed and performance data. It's nice having that feeling again, just knowing it can be the best a car can be when it comes to driving. And again, it's cheap. It costs less than 30 grand base price. And it can seat four-ish, with room in the back for groceries. And it can drive in the snow, and you're not gonna cry too much if you get into an accident. It really is the perfect car for this perfect generation. It's also damn good fun, too. So, here are our finalists from 1930, the Z-Type. From 1940, we have Albany with the Hermes. From 1950, Lampadati with the Pigalle. '60s American Muscle with the Classe Mamba. The 1970s/1960s Pegassi Monroe. The 1980s Super Saloon Future of the Ubermach Zion. One of the greatest sports cars ever made, the Progen GP1 from 1991. The 2000s technological revolution of the Coil Voltic, the first electric supercar. And the 2010s with the practical, cheap, fun to drive Dinka Blista Compact. This left me with quite a debate between a fair few cars, and I'm not sure yet. I think it's time to do some deliberating, if you ask me. And the winner of the best car ever made, all things considered, of all time, is the 1993 Trojan GP1. All other cars on this list were very impressive, make no mistake. However, this thing really took the ballpark to a new level. It pushed the world speed record to a new zip code and held that record for a decade. And to this day, it's the fastest naturally aspirated production car. And unlike the Trophy that beat it in 2005, this thing can actually handle, and it sounds better. So your argument is invalid. Alright? It can handle, it has exclusivity, it's fast, it's legendary, and it looks good. That meets every single criteria I can physically imagine for the best production car ever made. So, well done, Trojan.